Hi, my name is Ben Shepherd, and along with Giannis Mostros, I co-edit Global ETF Profits. Right now, Giannis and I are very bullish on the emerging markets. There are a lot of structural trends going on in those regions that really represent some phenomenal long-term opportunities for U.S.-based investors. Just off the top of my head, the most immediate argument for investing in emerging markets that comes to mind is just the sheer pace of growth going on in those regions. Just as for an example, looking at the BRIC countries, Brazil is expected to grow in excess of 6.3% this year. Russia's a little slower at 4%. China is expected to turn in a huge 10% GDP growth in 2010, and India is expected to grow somewhere in the neighborhood of 8.5%. If you compare those growth rates to what we're experiencing here in the U.S., where our gross domestic product is expected to grow between 2 and 2.5% this year, you know, the opportunity just pales in comparison. While Giannis and I are very bullish on America and we do see a number of opportunities here domestically, the simple fact is the U.S. is transitioning to a more European-style, slow-growth economy. Just to hit on a few of the themes going on in the emerging markets, one of the biggest, perhaps, is the emerging markets consumer. A lot of these emerging market economies are being driven by commodity exports, which is just funneling a huge amount of wealth into South America and into Asia to some extent. The middle class in these countries is growing at just an exponential pace. For instance, in India, consumer spending driven by the middle class is expected to reach $20 trillion over the next decade. And just for a point of comparison, that'll be twice the consumer spending here in the United States. The BRIC and emerging market countries are very much shifting their economies from being export driven, being all about fueling consumer demand here in the US or in Europe, to meeting their domestic consumer demands. And that's driving a phenomenal growth spurt for domestic consumer-oriented companies in the BRIC nations. Another major theme that's developing in the emerging markets, particularly in India, is infrastructure. You know, a lot of folks don't find infrastructure very sexy. I mean, here in the U.S., we have electricity on demand. All we have to do is flip a switch. You know, we live and work in climate-controlled environments where, you know, the air conditioning or the heater kicks on when the temperature reaches uncomfortable levels. We have the benefit of instantaneous communication with landline phones, cell phones, the internet, text messages. And that's by virtue of the fact that, you know, here in the U.S., since the birth of our nation, we've just spent trillions of dollars digging canals, paving roads, installing telephone wire, cell phone towers, energy infrastructure, you name it. And I know, you know, in my household, we have three telephones. And there are days where all three telephones, you know, will be ringing at the same time. When that happens, I really wonder what the world was like before Alexander Graham Bell released the terror that is the telephone upon us. But, you know, in many parts of the world, they just don't have telephones. They don't have electricity. They don't have running water. They don't have internet infrastructure. And that's something that these countries are very eager to develop, and they're spending a lot of money doing it. Over the next 3 years, emerging economies are expected to spend in excess of $6 trillion of both government money and private sector money developing infrastructure, building power plants and water treatment facilities and, you know, installing telephone line and gas and oil pipes, all manner of things, airports, roads, you name it. That's a huge volume of spending, and that creates huge opportunities for Western investors. India alone is expected to spend $6 billion between 2007 and 2012. They're going to be building, right now they're expected to build 6 new nuclear power plants. They're expected to build, update, or expand at more than 50 airports. They're expected to build 3 new rail corridors in the country to transport both people and freight. Demographics are a major driving force between this rapid pace of Indian infrastructure spending. Every 2 seconds, someone is being born in India. They're expected to rank within the 3 most populous nations in the world within the next 10 years. Half of the population is aged 25 years or younger. And this, these tend to be fairly well-educated people, particularly in the urban areas. You know, a lot of major tech companies that are household names here in the West are either based in India or have major research and development operations on the subcontinent. A lot of electrification has to happen. A lot of communication infrastructure has to be installed. You know, clean drinking water has to be provided for all of these people, particularly in the urban areas where the population is slated to grow by 2% or more over the next 15 years, according to the United Nations. So again, while I understand that the theme may not be particularly sexy, the opportunity is there and the profit potential is there. The company is building and installing all of this new infrastructure capability. We're going to enjoy exploding profitability. And ETFs are one of the best ways to take advantage of that trend. That's because a lot of these contracts are going to locally owned and operated companies. They're going to local businesses. A lot of this work is not being done by Western companies trading, you know, in New York or in the UK or in France. And these can be very difficult markets for Western investors to tap into. ETFs bridge that gap, though. They're able to invest on the local exchanges, which, one, benefits Western investors by giving us access to the companies, and two, also benefits us because these transactions are being conducted in the local currency. So that provides us an excellent hedge against a rapidly devaluing US dollar. There are a lot of ETFs out there that look to tap into these trends, but not all ETFs are created equally. There are some big differences between how they go about investing, what types of companies they invest in, and even if they're actually tracking the theme that their name would lead you to believe. So Giannis and I spend most of our time sorting through the available ETF universe and finding the funds that really tap into what we think are the most important stories, both in the emerging markets and here at home. So we encourage you to take advantage of a subscription to Global ETF Profits. We welcome any questions you may have, and we look forward to working with you in the future.